Mr. John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. I'm still here in the Tampa area, and today actually I drove pretty far out of Tampa, and I'm on the north side of Tampa, somewhere out in the country. We're in the middle of pretty much nowhere, in my opinion, but I don't know where I am really. But where we are at today, we're at the property of Green Dreams FL. That's a YouTube channel for Pete Canaris. That's Greek, actually. And we're gonna go ahead and give you guys a tour of his place. Now, Pete does not do annual gardening. This is something that I focus on, that I teach a lot on my channel. He does more of a permaculture style, which on some levels, I have to agree with him, is more beneficial to the planet and to the people and less work for the person than annuals. And I want all you guys to grow more perennials. You know, maybe if you have acreage like Pete does, I mean, maybe you have a vegetable garden right near your house in like zone zero, but everywhere else you should be doing something what is Pete is doing here. I mean, I live in a tract home in the middle of a big city. I don't have space to do a big permaculture, an optimal permaculture orchard and situation like this. I mean, you could do permaculture on a small scale, but I've never really seen it work as well personally for food production purposes. Because, you know, the reason for my videos specifically are I want you guys to grow as much food as you possibly can. And if you're doing permaculture, there's lots of trees and other plants that you may not be eating all year. And if you have a small limited space to grow food, I don't think, I mean, for me personally, that's not the best investment in my space, but maybe it is for you guys. So anyways, let this be your guide. If you have acreage, definitely do this. Don't put in a vegetable garden unless it's right near your house. But you want to focus on a lot of the crops he has here. Also want to let you guys know that, you know, the crops that we're growing, that Pete is growing here, will do well in his area. Some are kind of experimental, and he has some amazing microclimates that I'll be explaining to you guys that allows him to grow crops that would not normally be able to grow here, right? I grow in a zone 9A. Pete is in a 9B, actually, and he has some amazing tropicals that, you know, some die back in the winter, some stay all year long, and due to some of his microclimates, he's able to keep alive year-round. And the other thing, unlike me, where actually I will water 4 times a day in the middle of the summer, you know, for small intervals to keep my plants moist so they don't dry out in an arid climate. You know, this is a humid climate, hot and humid. And, you know, and actually Pete does not irrigate. So if you look at some of these plants, I think this is like a pollinator plant, sweet almond, also good to smell if there's any flowers on here. But this is looking sad. Like, he's like, he probably didn't want me to show like all the stuff that's really drooping, that's looking bad. But you know what? This is part of nature. And actually, you know what? For him showing me this, I respect Pete more, because he's like, John, if it doesn't make it in its own, I don't water it. And that's what it is. That's true to life, right? And that's really cool. Like, so I'm going to show you guys his orchard here that literally hasn't gotten water in, you know, unless it rained last, which I don't know when it was. And it definitely should have rained. It needs to rain a little bit more because he needs the water, and he's got a well. So he could be watering this, but his choice is to not water, you know, some of his main growing areas. He does water his nursery, and he has a full nursery, which actually will be the link down below, because of the next video I'll be making a specific video about his nursery, which is an insane nursery unto itself that actually he will ship you guys plants. I'm not going to talk about the nursery in this episode, but make sure you click the subscribe button right down below. Click the little bell so you get notified as my new videos come out for the next episode on Pete's amazing nursery, basically perennial plant nursery. Like, if you're in a permaculture, this is a nursery you guys want to support, because he has some of the coolest, rarest plants I've ever seen, found in my life. And more importantly, he will ship it to you. He'll charge you extra, but he'll ship it to you. So I mean, here is a cranberry hibiscus. This is also known as a false roselle. The roselle is like more of an annual here, where this is more perennial. So I would say if you're gonna grow one, the roselle or the false, grow the false, because it grows a lot better. And this one has not been watered. It's doing pretty good. Some of the other ones, you know, like that one's doing pretty good. This one's looking a little bit more sad. How could I tell the plant sad? Well, I can tell the plant sad is tends to being like nice and erect. The plants are nice and droopy. And I'm kind of sad when I'm droopy too, but you know, so that's that guy. Anyways, what I want to do is go over the hedge here on the inside. And we got the like a mulberry, like literally a mulberry hedge with that'll produce edible mulberries. Oh, there's one on it. Let's see if it's ripe or too old. All right, edible mulberry. I didn't know I was gonna find this, though. There's some kind of spider web on it. Could be sweeter, but let's try it. I'll take that. Actually, I was eating some freeze-dried mulberries earlier. All right, so the first thing I wanna explain to you guys, in this area, basically has like a clumping bamboo here. He grows many varieties of bamboo. So some of which are edible. I'm not really going to talk about the bamboo too much, but what I do want to talk about is this area here. So number one principle that he uses that I would encourage you guys to do, whether you're growing permaculture style or not, is CYG, cover your ground. Look at this, man. He has like, he basically chops and drops things, just lets it compost in place. He plants like nitrogen fixing and other kind of plants as a ground cover, right? So whether you're covering the ground with like dried leaves and, you know, twigs and, you know, wood sticks, wood chips, whatever, or you're using actually a living mulch. I prefer a living mulch more because when you have a living mulch, the sun hits the greens, the plant produces basically sugars it sends down into the root zone to feed the mycorrhizae, the bacteria, the fungi, keep them happy. And you know, maybe second best would be to cover with some kind of wood chip so you protect and insulate, and then the fungi will come in, and the fungi, and maybe some fungirls too if you're lucky, will basically break down all the woody material and then turn that into more nutrition for the soil. So I like the combination he does here, basically using both methods. And then just come back here, and then he's growing a lot of this one. This is known as the Mexican sunflower. And I'm like, look at this. I'm gonna break his plants off. Wouldn't he be mad at me because I'm breaking his Mexican sunflower? I'm devastating this thing, man. I'm making a mess out of it. Come on, man. Tearing you up. Uh-oh, man. I better hide. He might kick my ass. No, just kidding. All right. He would probably appreciate I'm doing this. Why? I'm just going to drop it and leave it. Now, am I making a mess in his garden? No, I'm doing him a favor. Oh, my God. I just did Pete the biggest favor. Why? Because he grows this as a nitrogen-fixing plant. Maybe he wouldn't have tore it up as this bad, and maybe he would have a specific method to his madness. But that's why he grows this. If you see all these stems down here, that's what this stuff probably is. He probably just chopped this stuff down and dropped it. Now, does that look messy? Well, if you live in an area that has an HOA and people patrolling your streets, you might not get away with this. Like, I would never do this in my front yard. I'd get in so much trouble. But you know what? If you have your own acreage and no HOA to tell you what to do, this is the way we should be gardening, honestly, in my opinion. And when I have acreage one day, this is exactly what I'll be doing. Pete actually just came back from a conference somewhere, South America or something, and that even got him more inspired about growing more nitrogen fixing plants in even higher volumes than he does now, and even doing more chopping and dropping and leaving them in place and not even moving them from the area, but chopping and dropping in a specific method. Even when he prunes his fruit trees, right, he's not gonna pull that off and move it. He's gonna, you know, break it down with like clippers and chainsaws and drop it in the place to basically feed the soil, you know, the natural fertilizer, right? So you guys saw that Mexican sunflower that basically is a chop and drop, right? When he drops all that stuff down, what does it feed? Well, it feeds the soil microbiome. And literally 3 feet away from the Mexican sunflower is this guy. This is a moringa tree. Wow, and I love the smell of moringa. It smells so amazing. Mmm. And actually, I think I'm freeze-drying moringa, or it should be done when I get back, because I left it in the freezer when I left. But I'm freeze-drying my moringa, so now I can store my moringa for up to 25 years in the best way possible. And the freeze-dryer does freeze-dry leaves actually quite well. But this is another no-brainer crop. If you guys live anywhere here in, you know, the central South Florida area, moringa is definitely one you will want to plant. If it gets too cold, it may die back, but then it should come back the following year. With all these delicious leaves you could eat, it'll also make the flowers that are edible that you could eat. The seeds are also edible, also can be used for pressing oil, but mainly the leafy greens are also edible, right? They have a nice, I mean, in my opinion, peppery flavor. Mmm, nice and peppery. These also produce the isothiocyanates. They're basically anti-cancer properties. So this is like anti-cancer. It's higher in, you know, like calcium than spinach and all these different things. So one amazing plant. And also this is a perennial. So like a lot of the gardeners here in the South Florida area think, oh, I can't garden in the summer. That's when you got to take it off because I can't grow tomatoes and peppers. And they would normally start that actually right about now. And their season is in the winter. And for us that are northern gardeners, that's hard for us to even comprehend. But this is something that you can grow all year long here, except actually in the real winter when it does get too cold. And there's many crops that I want you guys to grow, you know, that he grows here year round, basically. And so on this video, as much as I'm going to talk about his perennial food forest, I really want to focus in on key in on some of these perennial vegetables, because I see in many food forest situations, they really focus on the fruit trees and they forget about the vegetables. You know, fruits and vegetables are the healthiest foods on the entire planet, and I want you guys to eat them in balance, and your balance might be different than my balance, but generally I see so much more fruit growing in perennial food forest systems than the vegetables. And so I'm focusing on the vegetables for you guys. All right, talking about vegetables, we didn't even have to walk two steps, maybe it was like five steps, and we get to this guy. What's this? This is Nopalis cactus. So you can eat these cactus pads. Do I dare eat one of Pete's cactus pads? Absolutely. We're gonna go up to this little baby here. We're gonna pluck him off like that. We're gonna make sure there's no like stickers that's gonna stick my tongue, and we're just gonna eat it. That's actually quite good. Definitely tastes better than aloe, and I don't want to eat any ants that are on here. But you know, Nopalis cactus, you know, many different, you know, peoples of the that were here before the white man came, you know, would eat the cactus. We can eat the cactus. Super good. You could just chop this stuff up, put it in salads, eat it raw, just right off the plant. I do encourage you guys actually to harvest the young tender ones, and watch out, even if you get a spineless variety, sometimes they'll have those little glaucids that will sting your tongue. So you want to basically just brush them off before eating. This looks like a fairly nice variety that actually has nice and thin pads that are probably more delectable for eating than some of the ones that I grow that are nice and fat. So the primary purpose of a cactus should be the edible leaves that it produces, like I just ate. But as a bonus, and here it is, the bonus, you should also get some fruit if your cactus is nice and happy. I don't know the variety of cactus this is, but we're gonna go ahead and pluck it off and look in the back. It's already gotten eaten by some kind of birds or insects, but that's all right, because you can just cut off the bad spot and eat the rest. You know, the leaves come on, the pads or the leaves or the vegetables come on all year, but it might be rare for the fruit, so you should savor your fruits when they come on. Let's go ahead and get out of where this cactus is and open it up for you guys. All right, so optimally I would have a knife, but I don't have a knife, but I got my fingernails better than a knife. So sometimes, depending on the kind of cactus, it might have glaucids in here. Luckily, this is like a thornless variety, although the plant does have little stickers there. We're just gonna go ahead and peel this back very carefully. So I think I've had one of these cactuses before in South Florida. And look at that, it kind of like on the inside, it looks like a dragon fruit. I love this. And actually, I just had dragon fruit earlier, white dragon fruit, like from the homestead area. It definitely wasn't that sweet. All right, so we just peeled this, and now we're gonna go ahead and eat the side that was not bit out. Oh my God, tastes like fluffy. I think the thing that gets me is, usually cactuses are kind of more like gelatinous. This one's not gelatinous at all. It's actually, when you're biting into this, it's almost like biting into like fluff. What can I compare it to? If you've ever had like sprouted coconut, it's kind of like sprouted coconut fluffy. The seeds are crunchy, and it's mildly sweet, right? Wild foods, wild fruits, not always gonna be super sweet like we always expect when we get fruits from the store. We've also bred fruits to be super sweet, and I really want you guys to appreciate more wild foods that are like unhybridized for its sweetness, but just more natural in nature. They provide actually, in general, more phytochemicals and phytonutrients, vitamins and minerals than calories, which I personally believe to be a good thing. So eat your wild fruit, guys. It's good stuff. One of the things I like that Pete does is he's basically created windbreaks and actually privacy fencing between him and his neighbors, basically with this clumping bamboo. So he's planted clumps of clumping bamboo that actually has a really nice tall wall here, and actually created a really nice microclimate. So now the wind doesn't hit this area to the other side. And the surprising thing is, this whole area behind me, this was designed originally for his annual crop production. He was gonna get into market gardening, market farming, and it just basically didn't work out. It was a lot of labor. He just learned he didn't like that. So then, even better than annual crop gardening, which you may have to till the soil in certain situations, he just turned it into perennial farming. And it just serves him a lot better because it's a lot less labor, a lot less work. He doesn't have to water any of these perennials. Some of them may look like the leaves are drooping. He also has basically like lots of stone fruits planted in this area and other fruit trees, and also a lot of those different lemongrass and cranberry hibiscuses. He's got like lots of different varieties of turmeric, the white, the yellow, the orange, the blue turmeric. He's like a plant collector, like on steroids, in my opinion. and so many different things growing. I don't have time to show you guys everything here, but I want to go ahead and try to focus on some of the things I thought were really important that he showed me that I want you guys to grow at home if you're able. So one of my favorite crops that I want you guys to grow if you're able, and you may need to protect this crop in certain climates, it does need a longer growing season. This is his turmeric. You're like, John, why are you showing his turmeric, man? Doesn't look that good. Well, maybe that's what Pete's thinking right now. But you know what? This is the life cycle. I like to just show things like it is. This is the end of the turmeric season. You know, as it gets colder, the turmeric plant senses that. The leaves start to look a little bit more yellow, turn brown, basically dies back. And that's the time you're ready to harvest it, spread it, you know, dig it up, you know, cultivate more of it, right? And I'm not really here to show you guys a turmeric that's kind of like looking on its way out. I'm here to really show you guys the ground cover. This is the amazing ground cover, a living ground cover, probably one of the best mulches you'll ever have, a living mulch. It's known as the perennial peanut. This is a nitrogen fixer. So normally he will trim this down right before it's gonna flower. He'll basically just knock it down on the ground, and then the root will release all the nodules to basically give nitrogen and more nutrition to the plants. And that's another thing, you know, Pete doesn't tend to add additional fertilizers once it's been planted. He might do some kind of top dressing with things like biochar and rock dust, but after that he does not like to disturb the soil. And you know, I think it definitely pays off for him, because I mean, just looking in this soil, look at this soil, oh my god, if you guys were here, like these are all like white, look at these white threads. I mean, that's like mycelium going, like this is totally insane. Look how healthy this soil looks. I mean, I want to remind you guys that we are in South Florida, right? This is where this is normally sand, right? What am I seeing here? I'm seeing like really nice, biologically rich soil here, not just sand that he is literally creating by creating a biological system. This is something that I take into consideration when growing my annual garden a little bit, but he is really doing it to the max here. If you guys want to learn more about how he grows all these things, because I can't get into super deep, check out his channel. It is a wealth of information. He has videos on probably most of these topics here, and if not, I'm sure he'll be creating them after this. All right, so another plant I want you guys to grow if you're able is this guy. Look at this. I mean, this extends not quite as far as the eye can see, but at least for another 20 feet. Basically, this is another ground cover. In front of this ground cover, he has a perennial peanut grass. But then after that, he has these guys here as a ground cover. Now, this is just not a ground cover. It is sending the roots in the ground, and I'm getting bitten by mosquitoes. But it also provides food. So this is called the Thai pepper leaf plant. So you can just pick the leaves off. All these leaves are edible. I mean, this is literally better than having romaine lettuce from the store. It's just having Thai pepper leaves that you could harvest and eat raw in salads. Now, this one is used in like Asian cuisine, and most Americans are not familiar with it. It has a nice kind of like, I don't want to say basil flavor, but if you know, you when you eat the basil, you kind of get that, you get that essential oil flavor. It has like some kind of essential oil that's a little bit different flavors. And I want to encourage you guys that if things have flavors like that, that's, guess what? That's why the bugs don't mess with this plant, right? Also, this plant is very glossy. Look at how glossy that looks. To me, it looks like they're spraying on paint. Pete is not spraying on any kind of glossy paint. That's how this plant looks naturally. To me, this is such a beautiful plant to use as a ground cover. Works great in his specific situation. Once again, a lot of these plants may not do well if you freeze in the wintertime, because they're more, definitely more tropical. But it looks like if this one does die back, which I'm not sure, looks like it'll come back with a vengeance every season. This is currently being filmed in October, right? The next thing I want to do is I want to go ahead and eat one of these little flower buds, right? These little flower buds, they look so cute. This is going to be probably a rocket explosion in my mouth of different essential oil flavors, and I don't know. Wow. Oh my God. So it's like the leaf times about like 20 in strength. I would not necessarily recommend you guys eat those until I look it up to see if they're edible. And if so, don't do it in any specific quantity. Some of these Asian greens might need to be cooked to be properly eaten, but I know you can eat, you know, this leaf in small amounts raw. So Pete grows many different kinds of plants. I mean, Pete is a plant man, I think, through and through. And he has so many cool new ones and ones that I'm learning about myself, including this one. This is known as porterweed. And I guess it's native to Florida, right? And that's a cool thing. You know, there are some native plants that are also edible that we can use. And the reason why I like this one is because it makes these cool, basically purple flowers, right? We could go ahead and pick off these flowers and just, you know, we could add these to salads, use them for edible purposes. sprinkling of flowers. And I like those because they're not astringent. They have a nice floral scent. And I want you guys to eat more flowers, right? When you guys eat flowers from the plant, you're getting some of the nutrients from the plant. You're also getting the pollen from the plant, which are basically amino acids. And you're also getting that purple pigment, the very important anthocyanin pigments that can increase your health. Although, you'd have to eat a lot of flowers to get a lot of this pigment. So I encourage you guys to eat these often and eat them regularly if you got them. I want to share another plant with you guys. This is basically a hibiscus. So, you know, you guys saw some hibiscuses have edible leaves, and I'll be showing you guys some in the next episode. All the hibiscuses have edible flowers. So this is actually known as the Turk's cap hibiscus. Don't eat the leaves, but you can harvest the flowers. Look how pretty that hibiscus flower looks in there, right? Now here's a ticket for harvesting flowers, right? You want to take the stem, hold it, and then you want to come back down here and you want to pluck and pull. Right in here, this little area here is going to have all that nectar. This is what bees collect. Why let the bees collect the nectar and concentrate it into their honey when you can harvest the nectar and eat it fresh yourself? Much higher water content and sweetness in there and nutrition than the bees will simply give you in their honey. In addition, many bees are not taken care of properly, so I don't necessarily recommend you guys buy honey from the store. But if you want to have honey, raise your own bees. I have a few videos on honey. If I remember, I'll put a couple links down below on raising honey or raising the bees in a more sustainable way, where you're actually really taking care of and looking forward towards the bees, health, than actually just trying to rob the honey from them. So to eat this guy, we're gonna go ahead and take the end. We're just gonna tip off the tip, and suck. And I got some of the juice out. Now we're just gonna bite the tip off. I like biting tips. In that little tip, you're gonna get the concentrated sugar, the concentrated nectar that the plant produced. And some of that nectar actually goes down into the root system to feed the bacteria and the microbes and fungi. So they're probably really happy creatures, because I'll tell you guys, this stuff was super sweet, super delicious. One of the things I like about a permaculture food forest style is, check this out, man, this is a huge tree. It's so big, I can't even hug it. And there's no wasted space in permaculture. Why? Because if we kind of go down lower, down below, we're gonna see, like, we have all this mulch material, which is great because the tree is feeding itself when it drops its leaves, basically compost in place. And then in addition, literally, like right next to this tree, we have this shampoo ginger growing. Look at this shampoo ginger. It's totally amazing. We're just gonna go ahead and pop one of these guys off. And if I was taking a shower right now, right, I could take this and put it over my head and squeeze. And squeeze. And maybe you guys can see that, right? I'm getting the shampoo ginger, like, it's like slimy on there, right? And we could take that, we could lather it into my hair, and we're probably the best shampoo, wow, and definitely the best scent that I've ever had. This is like the awapui. Ever have like Paul Mitchell awapui ginger like shampoo? Why buy the Paul Mitchell awapui shampoo when you can have the awapui ginger to shampoo your hair? Let's get another one here. Squeeze it out. They're not super juicy. Oh, squeezing it out. All right, there we go. We got the ginger dripping out there. All right, and we're just gonna go ahead and put it in my hair. Like, John, why your hair always look greasy, man? Well, that's because I put oil in my hair to kind of hold it in place, if you guys ever wondered that. But today I got the awapui ginger, and it's gonna hang out in there until I wash it off tonight when I get to the hotel. And it smells really nice too, and if my hair turns purple, we know why. All right, so in permaculture, they have different zones. So the zone right next to your house is like zone zero, then they have zone one, zone two, zone three. They keep going out in the zones. And basically, the more important zones that you have are things that you're gonna be harvesting regularly, using more. So you would definitely wanna have like more kind of like plants by your house, like herbs and vegetables, if you're gonna grow vegetables. You're gonna have maybe, especially near the house, you may have fruit trees that need some protection from your structure of your house. But I wanna show you guys next is actually these guys right here, which is what I would have right next to my house, including a raised bed, which actually I do not see Pete growing any annual plants. Like, I don't think I saw a tomato on the property. I don't think I saw any kind of kale or anything. He basically doesn't have time for that. He's busy running his nursery. He's busy making videos. He's busy going out and doing installs. He's busy doing all kinds of, playing with his family, his kid, take care of his wife, all kinds of stuff. He doesn't have time for annuals like I do, because I'm single right now. But he does have time for perennials that literally you plant once. Like, guys, if you guys live here, you guys gotta plant this plant. I'm not joking. This is like basically like a shrub, right? This is known as katuk. This is my favorite vegetable in the entire world that I grow in Las Vegas. Now that is a feat unto itself, because this is a tropical. One of my plants is kind of diseased. I got the plant last year. I made it through the winter by bringing it inside and growing it in my bathroom. No, that was not cannabis I was growing in my bathroom last winter. That was my two katuk plants with my, you know, whatever pink LED lights that may have shined out the window. Luckily, no cops came. Because this is so important to me, right? To keep this alive, and this will not make it out in the cold weather. I don't care if you mulch it. I don't care. If it gets too cold, this guy ain't making it. He has it planted towards his house so it stays a bit warmer. But to me, this looks like it's surviving every year in this climate here. But the other reason why it survives in this climate, even though it can get too cold here, is look up, right? Above us, right above the cameraman here, you can see these big overstory trees. That's a trunk I was basically hugging in the last shot, right? All the trees above basically create like a big greenhouse effect and create a microclimate, right? So if you guys are looking to buy property, try to find a property that has all these nice huge oak trees or other big overstory trees above, because guess what? That's gonna provide you guys a microclimate. So now you guys could grow some more tropical plants that other people that just live in the middle of a field cannot grow. And if you live in the middle of a field, plant these big oversized trees. But see, you're gonna have to wait to have these trees this big. So this is a blessing on this property to have these nice huge trees. Creates a nice microclimate so that he can keep katuk alive year round. That might not otherwise do well if it was just, you know, 2,000 feet over that way in the middle of a field, which is what most of the land around here looks like. So here's the thing, right? Katuk, all these leaves are edible. I'd rather eat these leaves than a salad, right? How you harvest these, super simple. Takes a second. Take your hand, go like this. Whoop! All right, look, the leaves are gone. They're all in my hand. And then step two, eat. These leaves have a nice nutty flavor, right? My friend says they taste like peanut butter. I don't know that I would go that far, but if you love peanut butter, you're gonna love katuk because it has a nice nutty flavor that you don't get in other leafy greens. And that's only if they're healthy. If they're healthy, they taste nutty. If not, they don't get that extra nut flavor, right? I like things that are nutty. But yeah, you gotta have proper, you know, because I've noticed on my katuk plants, if they're not healthy, they don't taste as nutty. And if they get the leaves that are nice and firm, then they kind of taste nutty. These are like kind of like on the mild end of the nuttiness spectrum, all right? They have a variegated katuk that I'll be showing you guys in the next episode. And besides just eating the leaves, you guys could also harvest the katuk tips. So we're gonna come over to these plants. And this is also something good to basically just break off the tips. You know, here's the end of the plant. As it comes up, we're gonna break it off. That's gonna promote more outward shooting growth instead of getting tall. And then these little tips here, especially this tip right here, you could eat this. This is nice and tender. Think of this as like tropical asparagus, right? Stem is nice and tender. Super good. I'm not even getting the fiber yet, all gone. Super delicious. Other thing about katuk that's really cool, right? If we go down more deeper on the stem, right? Not too far down, right? Don't tell Pete I'm doing this, but we're just gonna do this for you guys. We're gonna go ahead and break this off, right? I devastated this plant once again, all right? Now this is not used for chop and drop mulching, but we're just gonna go ahead and break this off. And if we basically just take this down to like one little stick, right? This is propagated literally by cutting. So literally you take this, and now we're gonna do Pete a favor, even though I chopped up his plant. We can just basically stick into the ground. And if it gets watered, then it's basically just gonna grow new roots and then grow a new plant right there. And that's like the John Kohler katuk plant that I planted. Right, so Pete has a nice pool, but we're not gonna show you his pool today. We're gonna show you guys this basically guava in a pot. But we're gonna go down, right? Yeah, he has lots of fruit trees, and fruit trees are impressive, but even more impressive to me are when people that are growing fruit trees are growing the perennial vegetables down below the fruit tree. So even in this pot, surrounding this pot, he has these greens growing around it. And I want you guys that are growing perennial food forests to grow more perennial vegetables down below your fruit trees, just as Pete is doing here, right? He has my seal of approval here. This one is called Ciso spinach, also known as Brazilian spinach. You know, this is rare that I get to see this. I don't only usually see this in like this coast, maybe Hawaii, but I rarely see this even in Southern California. There must be a reason why. Maybe it doesn't like the super cold temperatures, but it looks like to me that it is thriving here in his amazing 9B microclimate. So this is actually one of the plants I'll be taking back home in my next episode that you'll have to stay tuned for to see if I could get to grow, and I'll probably be one of the only people that have the genetics on the West Coast. So Ciso spinach, this can be eaten raw. I will say that I like the Okinawan spinach, the longevity spinach. even the Egyptian spinach more than this. It definitely has like a nice, it has a nice green flavor. I'm tasting like a little bit of astringency on it. But nonetheless, you know, if it's a green you guys should grow and you have acreage, right, you should plant patches of this everywhere. In some case, one patch gets devastated by bugs, you might have another one. And more importantly, you're always gonna have some vegetables to harvest from your garden. You know, I think for some of you guys who've never eaten CISO spinach, maybe if you're from Brazil, because it's called Brazilian spinach, you guys eat this, you know how to use it. You could cook it up, you could eat it raw. And here's the thing, people don't know how to use these foods, right? The thing, what I would say to you guys is this, right? Make a regular salad like you would with romaine lettuce, whatever kind of lettuce or greens you would normally use, and then pick like 5 sprigs of the CISO spinach, right? And just add that to your salad, right? Start incorporating these greens if you don't eat them in high quantities. And looks like, you know, Pete could probably harvest this a little bit better. And just incorporate a little bit every night, you know, 1 or 2 sprigs in the meal. You know, before I eat my dinners, I go out into my garden with a little colander and I go around and pick this, pick that, pick that. I come back with a big colander full, and generally that makes my salad or is in addition to other, you know, store-bought greens that I'm eating to supplement them, you know. But I always encourage you guys to eat more of the stuff you grew, you know, first, before you even go to the store. All right, so now I want to show you guys a weed, literally a weed that's growing here on the property. Once again, he has that Thai pepper right here. And then down below, this guy basically will reseed on its own. It's jewel of O'Pear. And actually, it makes these nice large leaves. I wish I could have nice large leaves like this on my jewel of O'Pear here. And this is basically another leafy green. This is a tender leafy green. This kind of reminds me of the texture of like a nice kind of baby lettuce. Right, you break it, and then let's go ahead and eat it. Now this one does not live year round. It'll basically just flower and drop seeds on its own and then just come back, maybe even with a vengeance. I found that it actually used to grow in my nursery, in my greenhouse really well, where I just grow it in a pot, it would drop seeds in the next pot, and then they would just come back, and I'd be able to keep them alive that way. But even in this system, it looks like he just lets them go to seed, they drop seeds, and they just come back wherever they want. The cool thing is he's growing the standard green variety, but he also has a rare variegated variety that I've never seen, and that will be in the next episode for sure. All right, so I want to talk quickly about the fruit trees that Pete plants here, right? So there will be fruit trees that he buys to plant, like he'll plant name varieties of loquats that are grafted, you know, that might cost him a fair bit of money, but he'll plant those in the ground because he knows that a loquat in this climate zone will basically last throughout the year. It's gonna take the cold without any challenge, without any problem. So he's willing to invest the $50, $100, whatever it costs for a nice established plant to put it in so he could eat some amazing name varieties of loquats. Actually, my loquat is actually from seed and it's done amazingly well as well. But then on the flip side, he will also plant things from seed, right? How hard is it to plant things from seed? You eat a fruit, you save the seeds, you dig a little hole, you drop it in the hole, and then the tree will pop up if it wants to. If it doesn't want to, that's all right. The only time you waste it is just to take the seed out and drop it in the hole, literally, because that's what he does. He may drop it in the hole, maybe top dress a little bit. But this guy right here is getting super huge. And in this particular zone, zone 9B, he's not able, supposed to be able to grow these guys, especially one this tall that's like maybe 20 feet tall now. This is one of the largest fruits in the world, if not the largest. This is the jackfruit tree. From seed, right? He's not gonna spend good money, $50, $100 on a tree that he grows if the cold, the winter time has a cold snap, it gets 25 degrees and he loses his $100 investment. I know some of you guys might invest in very expensive trees that might not make it in your particular climate. And I would recommend that you guys grow from seed to try it out first. If it grows well from seed, then invest in a tree or plant. You know, so he's got a number of these jackfruits really growing here nice and healthfully. I think some years it might die back to the stump, but this is all new growth for this season. And that one of the reasons why he's able to do this is, once again, look above us. Look at this amazing canopy above, this amazing overstory that basically will regulate the temperature down below. Of course, especially for, you know, some trees, they're not gonna get as much sun, but also it regulates the temperature, especially in the winter when it's most important, as well as the summer. It keeps it a little bit cooler under here, so it's probably nice to work under here as well. All right, another ground cover he's using, which I'm actually using as a ground cover too, which I'm stepping in the middle of. And actually, I wanna tell you guys that when I'm stepping in the middle of this, my feet sunk down, like this is nice and spongy. So what, that's a sign to me that says, number one, I shouldn't be stepping here. And number two, that he has some amazing soil because it's nice and fluffy. It's not all hard and compact, right? And he doesn't do any kind of tilling here. The microbiology will do the tilling for you. The earthworms, the millipedes, the bacteria, the fungi will do the tilling for you so that you don't have to if you create the proper system. And underneath this big overstory forest system with mulch on the ground, and then even on top of the mulch, he has the living mulch, the sweet potatoes covering the ground. You can harvest and cook the sweet potato leaves as a food. You could also dig up those sweet potatoes, those tubers, basically to eat as your primary starch source, which are a staple crop in some countries literally around the world. This is completely amazing. Now this stuff, I'm not gonna say it looks super good, but this is the end of the season on these guys, and these guys are on their way out. And once again, I show it like I see it. So Pete has a little bit over 10 acres, and he is using that actually quite well. Like, he's developed most of his acreage with the overstory that he has not like cut out any kind of big trees for the most part. He's basically just left them in place and planted around that underneath the understory, right? He recently acquired the property next to him that he's now expanding. And this is one of the best things I want you guys to do if you guys have acreage, especially unimproved, that is just basically flat land. Do what he's doing here, which is not put up screening, but it's right here, right? This is what you guys need to do. If you guys don't have land and you're not growing stuff on it yet, it's just a grass field, right? Get rid of that grass field, right? Go on chipdrop.com, call local landscapers, call people that would normally just dispose of all this amazing material, which is mulch, like at the dumps, and have to pay to get rid of it. Have them drop it on your property free, right? Super critical, super important, right? This is the best use of barren land, aside from planting on it, you can do is just getting big, huge mulch piles, and I'm gonna run up. Whoa! Check it out, man. We're all the way up here, and we're gonna come down. Woo! All right. So anyways, as you guys can see, that mulch pile is super huge, super gigantic. And here's the thing about the mulch pile, right? You don't need a tractor. You don't need anything. You don't need to do anything to it. Let it sit here for a couple, 3 years, as long as your neighbors don't complain that it looks unsightly. You guys are good, right? And after about 3 years, you're gonna come to the bottom of it, and we probably can't do that because this hasn't been here 3 years. Anyways, if I was to come to the bottom of this, and he does have a mature pile like way down the way, we would dig this up, and we would see the best, richest black soil that you've never seen. And that's what's gonna happen, right? Basically through a slow composting process, basically a fungal action, and even be better if you put, you know, you seeded some fungi in here, like some King Stropharia mushrooms, so they can start growing out of this and basically breaking the wood chip material down into good soil that has very high fungal material in it. Especially if you guys are growing in a perennial system, you will need more fungal dominated soil than bacteria. But if you're growing more annuals like vegetables, then you want more bacteria balanced, more bacteria than fungi. But even vegetable gardens are deficient in this fungal material. This is something I'm very passionate about, and I want more people to mulch with the wood chips, get the free wood chips, use the wood chips if you're not gonna get in trouble for it. Spread the wood chips in between your pathways in your raised bed vegetable gardens and let it break down over time. Of course, it will need to be in a tropical humid climate like this where it rains a lot, you know, in an arid climate where I live, if I get wood chips and spread them down, they don't tend to break it down that fast because it is so dry. But yeah, the wood chips, one of the best resources that you could get that you're probably not using. Pete's place is so big and I cannot entirely cover this in one episode. I might have to even do another one. I might have to come back another day. That's not gonna be this trip. But anyways, another tree I wanna show you guys is this. This is an amazing tree. It's kind of even like kind of folded over and just coming out. It's so large, but check it out, right? Most trees we grow for fruit, it'll make all the leaves, and then we wait for the fruit like impatiently, right? This tree, you don't have to wait for the fruit, right? You could just come and break off the leaves, and basically you're gonna take this leaf and you could cook this up. Don't eat this one raw. This is known as the large leaf chaya. Look at this, look how much food this could be, man. Imagine sauteing this up, cooking it up, steaming it up, right? This tree is just bountiful with leaves. Now for the tastiest leaves, I'd always encourage you guys to go around and pick the young baby tender ones. They're gonna be a lot more delicious, a lot more less fibrous than the large ones. But this one does need to be cooked. But once again, you know, you can grow your own greens outside your house really quickly and easily by planting one chaya tree once, keeping it alive year after year, and you're gonna have lots of leafy greens to eat. You know, I've really tried to focus on the leafy greens in this episode because I want to encourage you guys that are into permaculture, get those greens in your garden. You know, there's other ones Pete has around here: longevity spinach, genera procumbens, genera bicolor, the Okinawan spinach. He grows Egyptian spinach that comes back every year, but that's past the season. So many different greens you guys should grow, and definitely subscribe and stay tuned for the next episode where I'm going to get into a lot more of them that he's selling in his plant nursery that he may not have planted in a spot that I could have easily found for this video. Last thing I want to talk about, this fruit tree. Well, actually, one of the last things. So this is a star fruit tree. One of the things I learned this trip is that these star fruit flowers, which are right on here, and here's a little baby flower, right? You could go ahead and harvest these little flowers, and they're little dainty, delicate things. Not going to provide you guys a lot of food, but really nice to add to a salad or something, and you can just basically eat them. So this kind of reminds me more of like a sour grass flower. Not like super astringent, super sour, but just a tad bit, right? Now, guess what? If star fruit is flowering, maybe look below, you might find some fruit. And as luck would have it, we have our fruit underneath here. Now, this guy, this part of the fruit, look at that. That looks like all like banged up, damaged, dented. You know, it looks like maybe there's some fruit fly damage in there. So we're gonna, you know, do my best to use my nail as a knife and basically break this off right around the bottom so we don't get any contaminated part. And that kind of worked. And then we're just gonna go ahead and break this up a little bit hard. Break it open on the inside and then go mallet. And suck. Oh my God. This is the best juice I've ever had. Straight out of the star fruit. These guys are really juicy. Look, I could take this and juice it with my hands. Look at that. Look how much juice is in this. This is the best juice. I mean, if you guys have a food forest like this, you guys shouldn't be buying juices in bottles. You should be taking this fruit, juicing it up, and sharing that with your family. In addition, this stuff is so delicious. Now, the problem with star fruits is that it fruits multiple times a year, not just once a year like some tropical fruit trees. You can have lots of star fruits, so you gotta do something with it. And I would probably recommend either like freezing it and you could use it later, or better yet, freeze drying it. Oh my God, I gotta try freeze dried star fruit one of these days. This is a higher water content food the freeze dryer may have challenges with, so you're gonna wanna take it and slice it thin, across ways, so you don't have a lot of skin area for the freeze dryer to try to freeze dry through, and it should work pretty good. Definitely really good. So I want to show you guys one more area of Pete's permaculture food forest before it gets too dark. All right, now I want to share with you guys actually what Pete is doing on another border of his fence line. And look, on the other side of the fence line, it's basically just all weeds and just shrubbery and things growing. But basically he's created a nice little area, buffer zone, in between him and his neighbors that he's got basically these logs. No logs are wasted here on the property. These are going to break down and feed the soil, also provide basically a buffer from keeping the soil back. He also has these berries, some kind of like blackberries or something growing there. He also has these olive trees, right? It amazes me that he could grow olive trees in this climate zone when it's actually so humid, because I'm used to having olive trees in the dry area. And if we go back even further, if you guys look down this row, he's planted sugarcane. Sugarcane grows great in this area. And if I will move to some place that could grow sugarcane this good one of these days, because it is one of my favorite crops in the whole entire world. And actually, he has a special variety of sugarcane from Louisiana. This is like a Louisiana sweet sugarcane that he has basically planted all the way down. He even has a sugarcane juicer that he could juice up his cane to make that delicious sugarcane juice that even has less sugar than orange juice and is rich in phytochemicals and phytonutrients, as well as some different, you know, beneficial waxes that the sugarcane makes. You know, the sugarcane will have this like kind of glossy white coating on it, and that's not dust or dirt, that's a wax that the sugarcane makes to protect itself from invaders. But also when we get that, you know, they've shown some beneficial effects from published research studies. Anyways, the last part of this episode before I interview Pete is I want to share with you guys actually what's in his greenhouse or his hoop house that he got for free. So for those of you guys that have real acreage in a real farm, you can apply with the NRCS, which is the agency of the government of the United States, and they can give you or provide you the money for a free hoop house for in-ground planted plants. They will not give you a hoop house for growing nursery stock, you know, that are in trays. But if you're improving the ground, like definitely Pete is doing here, basically you will just have to put the labor up to put up the hoop house. So that's amazing. He took advantage of that program, and I'm glad and proud my tax dollars went to buy hopefully a pizza hoop house here. Now, if we step into the hoop house, right, what do we have here? Now, now inside here, we have more tropical plants that could not otherwise survive outside. In addition, look at this, man. This perennial peanut grass is like 6 inches thick inside here. This is totally amazing. This is optimal ground cover. Now, he does use irrigation inside here because these are some of his special babies. And I don't know, these are just all different kinds of tropical fruits here. Oh, I want to show you guys one that I think you guys should grow if you guys live in the tropics. This one here is called the Suriname cherry, but it's a special variety. It's a purple Suriname cherry. So I want you guys to look at the darkness, the deepness. Most Surinames are like kind of like a reddish, but this is like a nice deep purple color. We're going to go ahead and pluck that guy off. Nope, got a mosquito there. And we're going to go ahead and eat that. Make sure there's no bugs on it. That's a big seed in there. Definitely good. But look at this. Inside here, he's literally modeled a forest system inside the hoop house so he can grow bananas. He grows bananas outside the hoop house, but inside here, they basically produce a little bit better for him. He has, oh yeah, look at all these bananas here, man. Amazing. But he has like so many different things growing. I don't even know all the different things he's growing. Some are like super tropical that now he can keep alive for free because of the NRCS, and now it allows him to basically create an additional microclimate that he would not have just with his overstory plants by putting, you know, a hoop house up and plastic overhead that actually I think he needs to work on because I see some holes. Anyways, we're running out of time in this episode. What I'm going to do next is actually we're going to go ahead and interview Pete, asking some questions about why he decided to do the permaculture style thing instead of the annual vegetable garden thing, learn more about him and his business as well as his YouTube channel. So now I'm here with Pete Canaris of the Green Dreams FL YouTube channel. First thing, I want to thank you, Pete, for having me out today. I've had so much fun, as you guys saw in the video. Hopefully you guys had some fun watching it as well. We're going to ask him some very important questions about his permaculture food forest that he has growing here. I love my time here. So first off, Pete, you've done an amazing job. I'm so amazed. Like, I aspire to be like you, actually, one of these days. I have a wife, a nice kid, and actually a nice, beautiful food forest. Because I live in the city in like a small residential area, so I don't do like permaculture. Gotta do annual crops because that serves me better in my space. But here in my right mind, I would never put in an annual garden. I would probably have a small one, but I would do kind of what you did. So like, I definitely agree with the permaculture style on a big scale where he has one of him and a lot of work to do and a family to take care of, a dog to feed even. So Pete, why don't you grow? I mean, you know, I don't think I saw one annual, not even a tomato or a lettuce or a pepper or nothing here. Why don't you grow those?
It's mostly just time, John. You know, to be honest with you, when I first got into this, I found your channel. You know, you definitely inspired me and kind of put me on the path, and it's evolved since then. And it really comes down to timing. You know, we do some annual gardens and stuff for clients, but at the end of the day, I don't have, you know, least amount of time for my own place. So with the perennials, you know, they're set it and forget it. With our heat down here, with our high humidity, our crazy rains, I mean, these are the things that survive and thrive, you know. I don't really want to be out there babying plants and replanting, even though I do enjoy lettuce and kale. You know, I have friends that do a really good job of it. I'd rather trade them some fruit for it, just because I literally don't have the time myself.
Mm. Right, and once again, you know, definitely in a certain climate zone, perennials might make sense, but other climate zones like, but you can do perennial food forest style, even in Canada. So you did you visit the one, there's a guy in Canada doing food forest, or?
I'm good friends with him, Stefan. You know, I follow him a bit too, and no, I haven't been to his place though. That is a goal, you know, and I know there's a lot of research too, you know, things pointing towards perennial vegetables being more nutritious. Yep. I mean, everything was perennial based a certain amount of time ago. I think annuals is kind of something new here, you know, and they've been bred so far, you know, from their wild origins to where, you know, the perennials, we have deeper rooting plants, you know, much more nutritious. That's why when we're out here and you're tasting that stuff, you know, you're tasting the minerals, you're tasting the nutrients, you know, so I think it's all the way around. It makes sense. It's just getting used to eating something different that I think for most people, they're like, what is that? You know, but it will grow. It's easier to grow. And once you get used to it, you know, the benefits, I think, are going to be better all the way around.
Right. So, I mean, once again, this is a zone 9B. So if you want to grow things similar to here, you should also be into zone 9B. Maybe you can get away with some of them in zone 9A, but I've tried some of these plants in zone 9A and they haven't worked for me easily without major protection in the wintertime, which, you know, I don't want to put time into stuff more than needed either. Although I do tend to my, you know, standard annual vegetables a lot, but you know, on a small scale for me personally, because my goal is food production, not necessarily, it's trying to be as sustainable as possible. But you know, if I just put in a lot of fruit trees on my property, my small property, I would barely be eating any parts of the year because I wouldn't have production, because some perennial crops like fruit trees may produce once a year, maybe produce a couple times a year depending on the fruit tree. The perennial vegetables, if I could get them to grow in the winter when it freezes, I would totally have all the ones that I share with you guys in this video, all the greens. I grow as many of those as I can that I could take care of easily and keep alive during the winter. And then I usually bring them back and grow them as annuals in my garden, because we do get down to 25 degrees. Well, last year, and normally we'll peak down into like 30. How cold do you guys get here?
I think we've seen teens our first year being here. One of the brutal years, you know, we had 2 years ago, 24 degrees for 6 hours. So, you know, I mean, you see us growing tropicals, bananas and things like that, you know, and a lot of our trees defoliated and browned out, but everything recovered. You know, we lost maybe one or two mangoes or things we shouldn't have been growing. I was pushing the edge a little bit more in the beginning. You know, I'm kind of a little bit more focused on tried and true now. But, you know, I think even with these perennials, like you said, I think they can be grown as an annual in some areas. Like I just did a moringa video and had somebody in Washington State tell me they grow moringa. Wow. They bring it in, you know, every year in the wintertime, the leaves get a little yellow, they put it back out. I mean, these trees grow so fast and quick. You know, something like a moringa, like, so what if you restart it every year from seed?
Yep, exactly. That's what I end up doing, that because I have one tree that makes it, and other ones I try to grow them. And then sometimes I put it in my greenhouse, sometimes I forget. And one in the ground and where the south-facing wall is, and I covered it a little bit, has come back reliably for the last 2 years. And then one in a pot came back this year, but I put like 12 of them in my greenhouse, non-heated, and only one of those came back.
Wow.
So, I mean, so it's just like kind of risky, but I don't care. Like they sprout so quick, they grow so fast. Like I just buy a new plant next season if I lose it. And that's all right with me in my current state. I mean, I hope to live somewhere like you. So let's talk about like, you're able to keep something like a jackfruit or even more tropical fruit trees alive, even though you're a zone 9B and you should not be able to really grow some of these more tropical plants. How do you do it? What's your secret?
Well, I'll tell you, the first thing I've found out is the plants don't read the books. they'll tell you it can't grow, but I'd say with a lot of these things, especially the quick growing things from seed, like a jackfruit, like a Rolenia, like a sugar apple, that can fruit in a couple years. You know, like some things could take 6, 8, 10 years, like avocado, mango, something along those lines. When we're talking about something like a jackfruit, like those have potentially fruited in 2 to 3 years.
From seed?
From seed.
Wow. I learned something new.
I've heard under 2 years, you know, so they can be extremely quick, you know. So we had one in the greenhouse that was just setting its first fruit before we had that horrible freeze I was telling you about. And the tree completely defoliated. You know, here we are 2 years again later and it's flowering again.
Mm.
You know, so, you know, with starting those things from seed, it's not like I'm starting a grafted tree. If it dies, it's just coming back from the rootstock like it was initially.
Mm. So basically, yeah, that's because I showed the jackfruits you planted from seed, and you have that amazing top story. So you want to talk about that, how that creates a amazing microclimate that literally you moved into, because that was all here. He couldn't have grown that in the couple years he's been here.
Yeah, so, you know, when we first moved to the property, like I told you, we originally had a market garden. We did some annuals. I planted that large bamboo windbreak to close on the wind. You know, so that kind of closed us in a little bit more. It's something we look at with permaculture, you know, where's the wind infiltration coming from? Typically speaking, those cold winds come out of the northeast in the wintertime. So that's where we're looking for the most protection. But because I have these grandfather oaks that are 80, 100 foot tall, you know, they kind of act as a blanket. They make a dome effect over my property. And a lot of times it's not just the cold that kills the plant, but it's the frost that sets on the plant.
Mm.
So it sets on those trees, you know, before it actually sets down into the canopy. So, yeah, I mean, I have a laser recorder for temperature, you know, and I've been out here on cold nights and, you know, I've recorded in the same part on the same time on the property, a 12 degrees temperature change, you know, up against my house on the side compared to out in the open field. You know, so it would be 30 out here and 42 next to the house. You go in the canopy behind the house. You know, maybe it's only 6 to 8 degrees warmer, but it's like a, you know, a complete bubble of a microclimate.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty amazing. Yeah. So it's really allowed us to push the edge on some things we shouldn't grow, you know. And like I said, we've had some things defoliate, but everything seems to come back, even like the star fruit. You know, we had that year where they completely defoliated and they fruited again the following year. You know, they came back from above the graft. So, you know, we're not losing anything.
Cool. So let's talk about some of the fruit trees, like more tropical fruit trees you grow here that produce reliably, that somebody might want to try if they, you know, live in this local Tampa Bay area or even a little bit more north or, you know, east or, you know, even south.
Okay. You want me to go through them all, John?
No, I mean, go through some of the easiest ones that are more reliable fruiters, you know, that you know are going to do pretty well for people, because it's like things that I might want to try living in a zone 9A even, that are doing good here in your zone 9B, that like, okay, this is a tropical, but it's pretty solid, and it always comes back with fruit every year. Like, ones that are just going to be really, you know, better to try than others. So, you know, and be more fruitful, literally.
I would say one of the ones can almost try in most all zones would be mulberry.
Yeah, of course, mulberries.
You know, I've been very successful with mulberries. We grow all different shapes and sizes, everything from an everbearing, world's best everbearing.
World's best, I gotta try that
one. A giant variety, a white variety, a lavender variety, a Pakistani variety that gets 4 to 6 inches long. And these trees, you know, they thrive on neglect. They're out here on no irrigation. They can take our summertime heats. You know, they defoliate in the wintertime. That'd be the only downside. So, you know, it's not like when we're designing a house in an edible ecosystem, it's not something we put in the front yard that's going to lose its leaves or go dormant in the wintertime. You know, that's something that's going to go in the back. And we'd put something like maybe a loquat in the front yard. Like, we grow all different varieties of grafted loquat. And these are like a small peach.
Yeah, of course.
You know, they're delicious. They're in the rose family, commonly confused with kumquat. But, you know, they're naturalized all over the state of Florida. They're not native here. But there's been select varieties, like out in California, we have the Big Jim. Yeah, you know, down here we have Golden Nugget, Champagne, Christmas. I have 10 or 12 varieties. I mean, those are just excellent fruit trees. Very reliable, easy fruiters. Something that I'm just starting to get fruit on first time this year is avocado. You know, we have 3 different races of avocados. So we have a West Indies, we have a Guatemalan, we have a Mexican race. And all of the Mexican race avocados are very, very cold hardy. That's like Poncho, Lila, Lula, Brogdon, you know, those ones will take into the teens. So, you know, I don't think it matters where you are. You should almost, you know, at least in the South, be able to try or push avocados. You know, I mean, we're kind of, that's one, you know, if you lived in the right part of Florida, you could have avocados for 6 months out of the year with some of these early, mid, and late, but more cold sensitive varieties. So, avocados is definitely one that I would suggest grafted too. So, you know, pick a good variety that works well and suited for your area. You know, if you are up to, you know, zone 9 or something, I think you could probably push avocados. The next one that I think I've probably had the most success with, starfruit, caramel.
Starfruit, wow.
You know, they're super easy. They thrive on neglect. They came back after the cold. Super heavy producers. Almost every time you go outside, there's fruit on the tree.
But they don't like the wind.
They don't like the wind. They can take the shade, and they don't like the wind. You know, that's something that we found with bananas, too. Bananas, you know, we look at a banana as a jungle species. You know, these evolved in a rainforest. They're not a pioneer species. They didn't come up in the middle of a field. So they can take some dappled light, you know, and they might not as produce as well as the one that's in the full sun and gets the heavy water, but we'll still get the production in the understory. We get a little bit more protection, you know, so it allows us to kind of maybe grow bananas where we shouldn't grow bananas per se. So those have been probably some of my most successful. I'd say my favorite fruit tree here, and it fruits a lot, is Japoticaba.
Japoticaba, yeah.
Yeah, you know, those are very cold hardy, and I would say...
Down to what?
Mid-20s.
Wow, 25, mid 26, 20s, they can handle some freezing.
Yeah, even if they defoliate, they
but
come
how,
back.
But for how long, though? I mean...
I've heard 6 to 8 hours, you know what I mean?
So, almost. Like, overnight, if your days warm up... And
overnight, then, yeah, but I would say this is a plant you could grow anywhere you are, even if you're in New York City. I mean,
you could always bring them in the wintertime, yeah, I mean, yeah, in a pot.
Well, imagine a Japoticaba Christmas tree.
That's crazy.
With fruit, that'd be so you know cool. What I mean?
A red one, nonetheless.
Yeah, you know, I mean, that's you got cool. The ornaments on the tree, all you need is the lights. So, you know, I think no matter where you are, you can grow that on a porch, you can grow that on a balcony, you can grow that in a house, like, I grow, I'm on 11 acres, and I have a lot of my favorite ones in pots right up against my house.
Yeah, no, I mean, I share some of them.
Yeah, they do great in a container long term. So those are probably the ones that maybe I'm the most excited about, but we have a lot more diversity beyond that. You know, we're growing lychees and longans and, you know, mangoes. And
those are all more experimental, right?
For the most part. You know, I would say that the lychees and longans, you know, take 26, 28 degrees. Not really too experimental. You know I can get them to grow here. If I, you know, we only get, you know, we're being in Central Florida here, 6 to 8, 10 maybe cold nights a year. If you can protect or get through those couple of cold nights, whether it be overhead irrigation like Josh uses at Hart, whether it be, you know, a little heat out there, maybe making some fires, building a cold frame. There's all different types of ways to even push the edge. You know, I kind of like to say if there's a will, there's a way. So, you know, if you want to get these plants to grow, you know, play in the dirt, try them.
Yeah, I mean, for me personally at this point, I really don't want to work too hard to, like, wrap things, but I would do what you did, get a free hoop house from the NRCS. So you want to talk about that? I mean, I would definitely put that up and grow things in there and just have it hooped and not heated inside, but that alone would, how many degrees does that get you? by having that hoop house up?
You know, I think what that's mostly doing is stopping the frost from settling, because I'm not adding any heat. I get a couple degrees out there, so we've put those large black drums in the front, filled those with water, so they build up with some heat during the day and hold that radiant heat at night. So we're not getting the frost settling on them, and it's getting
full. And that's the main thing.
Yeah, they're getting full sun, and we're getting a little bit quicker production out there. But yeah, that was an NRCS high tunnel. Just contact your local NRCS USDA. It's literally like a 90-day process to get approved. You have to put the money up, and it's a reimbursement program. So the only thing that really came out of pocket for me was labor. And that was a good bit of labor. That wasn't too fun. I might even hire somebody if I was to do it again. It was a project.
And that's open to farmers, right? Not just homeowners.
You know, I don't know if I'm technically a farmer. I mean, we're zoned ag. I think you just have to be on ag zoned land.
You have to be an ag.
You got to have the space for it. You know, obviously you can't just drop
it. And it has to be in the ground, like plants in the ground, not
plants
on
in the ground is one of the rules.
Trees, yeah.
Yeah, they've caught me with some stuff in pots in there and said,
Oh, really? They even come back to inspect.
They do, especially in the first year or two. You get a couple of inspections. Yeah.
Wow. So you got to make sure you're using your government money properly.
Yeah.
Very important.
Yeah, but I will tell you, not only did they come back, he came back and he brought his boss. He brought his boss's boss.
Wow.
They took pictures.
So not only will they come back, but they're going to fine-tooth, nail, and comb you, man. Well, maybe you won't want them in your business.
I don't think they've seen what we were growing in ours. You know, so most people were growing annual vegetables like that. You know, like, what's
this?
So
they're a bit different.
Oh, you got perennial peanut. What are these? Bananas? What kind of bananas? We've never seen a banana like this. So it was kind of cool. You know, I mean, we have Barbados cherry in there. That's definitely a
subtropical.
Yeah,
I tried one.
That's one of those is like eating 10 oranges, vitamin C content wise, acerola. So, you know, I'd let them try some neat stuff too. Maybe they kind of are trying something different now.
Cool. So we talked a lot about the gardening. Let's talk about your YouTube channel. So you have an amazing YouTube channel, dude. Like, I watch this guy's YouTube. It's amazing. I've learned so much from your videos, man. So thank you for having us. Why did you start your YouTube video to, you know, share this with others and inspire people, you know, to grow food in a perennial, permaculture style?
Oh, to be honest, you know, I never saw myself holding the camera or really getting into YouTube. I didn't have time for it. I'm a busy guy. You know, I obviously have a day job. We're out there installing these systems. I'm busy. And I had a well-known YouTuber like yourself, Justin Rhodes, come by here. And he was doing the Great American Farm Tour, and he challenged me actually to do 30 videos for 30 days.
Wow.
And I was like, wow, you know, okay, maybe I'll do two minutes unedited videos with my cell phone. And that's how it started.
Oh,
I
cool.
mean, you know, this phone right here is my first 40 or 50 videos. And as I progressed, my wife started helping. And before you know it, you know, I would say that we bring a very well-edited, grabbing you type video to the table now. You know, our whole idea is, you know, we really want to just inspire people and spread this education and spread this knowledge and kind of make permaculture sexy, you know, like make it cool, make it something that people want to do. Like, you know, I would like to see, you know, a food forest be like the Ferrari in 2020, you know, like instead of, you know, everybody trying to have the new fancy car, like let's see whose food forest could be cooler. You know, that's how we're going to bring this to the mainstream, you know, MTV Cribs Permaculture Edition. You know?
Yeah, you know, that'd be so awesome, like, dude.
What's up? We want to change the world here. You know, that's what we got to do. We're going to have to play the game on the mainstream. You know, that's where we got to go. So, you know, I'm having a really great time. I'm excited where this camera takes me. I'm excited who this camera brings over. I'm just grateful for everything this has done. It's been just an amazing experience for me and very positive. Positive. It keeps me going. It keeps my fire lit reading the comments and seeing the response from people. So, you know, right now we drop two videos a week every Tuesday and Friday at 5 p.m. and trying to make it like your favorite TV show. Like, you know that Pete's going to be there at 5 p.m. on Tuesday and Friday. And it's a lot of work, but, you know, we make it happen. And I strive to just get better and, you know, eventually maybe even be a full-time, you know, media company.
That's awesome, man. And you know, I want you guys that are watching this right now to make your video. I mean, look, Pete started with his freaking camera. His camera phone is probably better quality than the camera that I normally use to film videos, you know? And you don't have to edit your videos. You don't have to be professional. You don't have to even be in front of the camera. Like, one of the things I learned about Pete that I didn't know is, like, he really doesn't like to be in front of the camera. He'll be behind the camera showing you what he's seeing, give you guys, like, commentary, but he really doesn't like his face on the camera. I'm like, I'm interviewing Pete. You got to be in the camera. But he's a great guy on the camera, too. But he could do it either way. You guys all have something to share, to learn. Each one of us could motivate somebody else. Pete's going to motivate different people. Different people are going to follow Pete than follow me. But that's all right. I don't really want a bigger, you know, followers, more whatever. I want a larger pie. I want more people into this, following me, following Pete, following whoever they're into, to get more people growing. And you guys could play a role in that. If you took a 30-day challenge, why don't you guys take a 30-day challenge right now? Make 30 videos in the next 30 days about your gardening, about things that you're passionate about, to help change the world, because things are not coming from the top down. who's in the government is telling us to grow our own food and to eat the best food on the planet. Like, nobody, we got to do that ourselves. This has to spread. We need to get this movement bigger and bigger. And this is happening on a grassroots level, and you could all play a part, like Pete has, like I have, and each one of you guys could do that as well. Wow. So that's amazing, Pete. So Pete, where do you see yourself in the next 5 years? And this is something I probably need to take lessons from. I need to start doing some more goal setting. And I mean, I do see myself married with kids on a farm in the tropics in 5 years. So I mean, I will put that out there to the universe. And you know, I am currently single and looking for somebody that wants to live this lifestyle. But where do you see yourself in 5 years?
I would hope in 5 years, because we've been kind of the first guys here in the state of Florida to really kind of pioneer, I guess you could say, this, you know, edible landscaping, food forest installation. I kind of want to be like this catalyst in you know, teaching the other landscapers how to do what I'm doing. Wow. So, I really want to grow the media end of this. I would like to, excel in our videos and maybe have more people doing what I'm doing and be like a news reporting service for regenerative agriculture, for the new latest crop, for the new latest fruit. And then also have an education center, you know, where we're still, I don't think I'm ever going to move away from the plants, but I would like to start teaching these other landscapers what we're doing, you know. So eventually, you know, maybe you can still get Pete to come out and consult. Maybe you can still get me to come out and do a design, but hey, I'm going to say I have this company and this company in your area. Like right now, you guys, I'm traveling the state. I'm renting a house. You know, like we'll leave on a Monday. I'm away from my family to a Friday. Wow. You know, I'm gone all week. We do jobs all over the state of Florida. I mean, I do international consulting and statewide installation work. And it's really cool. I love doing it. But at the end of the day, you know, I want these other landscapers to get out there and start doing what I'm doing. You know, my goal is to teach other landscapers, you know, and train these other landscapers and come up with some type of level of certification to where it's like, you know, hey, we've been trained through Green Dreams, you know, we're installing these type of landscapes. I'll work alongside of them. I'll train them, you know, and if maybe, you know, they're installing the consultations and the design jobs that we do, you know. So I'd like to start shifting away from the, you know, the installation thing and really grow the whole education. So whether it be education, like I said, through people coming to an education center, demonstration site, tours, holding classes, and just growing the education platform with the YouTube.
Wow. Wow, man. I really value your goals and I wish you the best in that. Cause I mean, really what we need to do is we need to make a major consciousness shift. I mean, and you're truly, really trying to take it to the forefront besides you doing it. And you could only go to so many places and reach so many people. But if you start teaching every landscaper out there to grow and do permaculture installations and food forests, you can literally duplicate yourself and thousands of people across the whole state, and we can have a food forest in every front yard. Hey, that's my goal. Permaculture food forest in every front yard in Florida. That'd be so great. And I could travel anywhere in Florida, just, you know, talk to somebody and get some food in their front yard instead of having to go to the freaking health food store, which are very expensive here in Florida, or the farmer's market, which usually there's not a lot of farmers at the farmer's markets here because it's people reselling stuff. I mean, wow, what a dream, what a goal, man. I would encourage you guys out there too to make a difference in your industry, man, like grassroots. Like, wow, man, I hope that really is successful for you. And the other thing we didn't even get to talk about is that, you know, besides Pete having an amazing food forest here, he can help you guys install it. So Pete, I know you will go around to any place in Florida and install food forest, do consultation, get plants, and even provide the plants, right? You guys are going to see that in the next episode. I visit his amazing plant nursery. Make sure you click the subscribe button right down below and click the bell so you're going to be notified when my new video comes out. But so tell us about your business where you could help somebody. Say somebody lives here in the Clearwater, maybe even Miami or Boca Raton, like Orlando. You'll go there and help them and put in a food forest so it's as successful as yours that I'm seeing here that I got to share in this video.
Yeah, yeah. Unfortunately, like I said, there's not too many other people doing it. So yeah, we are that guy, you know, we are that company, you know, and we travel all over the state. You know, we're about a month to 6 weeks out on a consultation. Usually it's a two and a half, you know, month turnaround on design. You know, I have engineers that work for me. We provide really high level, you know, digital designs, you know, that are really, really top notch. They're done through AutoCAD. Everything is to scale. You know, then you'll get on the installation schedule, which tends to be a couple months out too, you know. So in a perfect world, we turn out 12 big designs per year and 12 small scale designs. So we push to install about 24 jobs a year. You know, and that's with the small crew. You know, I have two full-time guys. I have two full-time people in the nursery. I have me. I have, you know, somebody behind the scenes helping in the office. And then on the traveling projects, we usually bring in, you know, two or three kind of subs, we'll say.
Wow, that's so amazing that you could help people, because people always ask you, John, come out and help design my stuff. Well, I'm going to tell you, if you're in Florida, call Pete, man. Like, I do not design stuff. I don't do all that stuff. And the other thing with Pete is that you're literally what's called vertically integrated. You know, not only can you do design, but you will provide the plants, high quality plant starts. So why did you even start a nursery to have plants, you know, at all?
Well, what happened was, John, we'd started designing these jobs and putting this stuff together, you know, and I found I had to go to 8 or 10 different nurseries to actually find the plants. You know, I had to go to this one, I had to go to that one. And then also I noticed when I was going to this one and going to that one, you know, I'm seeing signs of herbicides in the pots. I'm seeing the fresh, you know, synthetic fertilizers on the top of the pots. And, you know, it's really hard to take all these plants that are on synthetic fertilizers and bring them into a job and expect them to all make it. It's like a weaning process. It's like taking that bodybuilder off steroids. So, you know, a lot of those plants that we broker, we bring back here, we wean them off, we give them compost teas, we give them organic fertilizers. Usually we wait a few months before we have to use them on an install. You know, in a perfect world, we have them here for 6 months before we even send them back out. So really, I mean, it just came down to nobody else is really growing this stuff. You know, the big nurseries that are around, like Zills, like he's in prime development area. Like Gary's not going to be here much longer. You know, I give Gary maybe 5 more years, you know, in the business, and, you know, he's getting bought out by big development. You know, he doesn't have a kid coming in taking his place. So, you know, there's a lot of room in the nursery game. Like, I'm not scared of competition. If you're watching this video and you want to become an edible landscaper, go for it. You want to start growing, you know, perennial vegetables, go for it. I promote more of that. You know, I mean, I don't want to be the only one doing this.
Yeah, I mean, at the same time, I always say, you know, we don't need a bigger piece of the pie. We need just a bigger pie. We just need more people getting into this. And then guess what? That's going to create more jobs, you know, and there'll be more people needed. Like people like, I went to the farmer's market this morning, right? And the guy's like, you could do microgreens as long as it's not within 5 or 10 miles from me. And I'm like, hey man, that's the wrong attitude. You want more microgreens growers, because then the pie is getting bigger. There's going to be more customers. And then if you're doing it the best, then if another microgreens grower that's at the market is not doing good, he doesn't produce as good quality stuff, they're going to go to you, because now you need to up your game. So never get lazy in whatever you do, whether you're doing a permaculture, whether you're doing microgreens, or just even in your own personal business, always try to excel and just be better than the next guy, right? And that's always something I try to do. I want you guys to do even in your garden, right? Do experiments. Hey, Pete, what's one experiment you did this last season that just really didn't do too well that you learned from?
Well, I planted some avocados near the bamboo out front. And I find avocados definitely start a little better in dappled light, and also didn't realize that I probably shouldn't have started in the dry season and then be too close to the bamboo, because the roots on the bamboo can suck about anything dry. So that was a little bit of a mistake. I'm like, okay, we're never going to plant in this area again. You know, everything seems to just be sucked dry over there.
Right. So, oh, let's talk about this. Oh my gosh. So is it true that you don't water? Like, I went out and showed your stuff that like has wilted leaves, and you probably might have not done that, but I'm like, I'm showing it like it is. But to me, like, wow, I value that he does that. He does not water large areas of his permaculture food forest because he wants it just to survive on its own. And if it can't, guess what? He'll just replace it with something else. He does water his nursery plants, so he'll have the highest quality plants to give you guys. But like out in the field, he doesn't water. So what's behind that?
I mean, you know, I guess you could say a little bit of trial by fire. You know, I'm not into babying things. You know, I want these plants to mimic a forest system. You know, we're trying to use permaculture in every way possible. So, you know, with the dense planting, the heavy ground covers, you know, for the most part, I would say 98% of the year, everything looks pretty good. It's in the spring, we get a heavy drought, and we're getting a rare early drought right now. I've never seen it looking that dry out there. You know, I almost want to go watering some areas, you know. We got a little bit of rain earlier. You know, I feel bad, but I know as soon as it rains, these plants are going to thrive and come back and survive. So, you know, just by going out there and giving them a little bit of water isn't going to baby them and make them any stronger. You know, we're not going to create strong plants by babying them. If we look at a forest, you know, who gets home from work and looks in their backyard behind the fence and sees the forest wilted and waters it? No, right? Nobody goes out there and fertilizes the forest. It's the same idea here. You know, that's what we're doing in this forest type system.
I mean, and that's the other thing. You're creating a stronger ecosystem, right? The soil bacteria and the microbes and the fungi like will prevent those plants from dying. They will release nutrients. You also have lots of organic matter that will act like sponges. So he's not like being intentionally cruel to his plants. He set up a system that will be all right if it doesn't get water for a period of time. It can't go forever, of course. And I probably wouldn't set up this system like in the Mojave Desert, where it is an arid climate, where water gets sucked out of things faster than you can say supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. So right situation. And you've also done a very excellent job at setting it up with the proper ground covers, chop and drop, you know, living ground covers, Wow. You did an amazing, and then there's that mulch pile that I got to show everybody earlier. Amazing. So you want to talk about how important mulch is to your gardening style?
Oh, mulch is our key to success. So that's my number one pro tip is mulch, you know, and not all mulch is created equally. I find that the mulch that comes from the tree services that has the wood in there, the twigs in there, the leaves in there, is the best stuff you can get. Typically, whatever that, you know, pioneer species, that climax species is in your area, that's going to, you know, probably be the best to use also, because that bacteria, that fungi will be present in your soil profile. So it's just like feeding the worms, you know, like I love to use oak. You know, but we look as the, you know, the mulch as being the skin of the soil, you know, just like on our arms, if our skin was gone, you know, we're opening up for infection, disease, you know, by putting the mulch down, we're covering that soil, you know, we're protecting it. And ideally we're planting too, you know, cause that mulch is going to break down over time. So we're adding ground covers, we're adding bushes, we're adding chop and drop species, you know, we're having the nitrogen fixers in there. You can't plant too densely. You know, I would say it's better to plant densely and thin down the road than to plant lightly and, you know, give those, you know, those weeds per se, you know, when the weed is really just an indicator species, it's nature, you know, doing its part. It's coming up and it's covering the soil. So, you know, the mulch here for us, it acts as a living, you know, cistern. I don't have any cisterns. I don't collect any water, but you know, when the rain does come, it sucks up into that mulch and it holds it in there, you know? So we're creating that mycelium, you know, the mycelium can literally take the humidity out of the air and transpire it as water into the soil, you know?
So every night your plants are really getting a little bit of water because it's so humid here.
With the humidity, that definitely does help. You know, things look a little bit better in the morning. Yeah, it's a game changer.
All right, Pete, so we're getting to the end of this episode and I have like two more questions for you. So the next question is, are there any questions that I should have asked you that I didn't, and what would be the answer?
Oh, wow, that was a good one. Any questions you should have asked me but you didn't? It gives somebody some education, you know, Pete, how do you get into this business, like for the people watching right now?
Good point. Yeah, I want people to start their own business and be independent of the man and do a job they love instead of a job they hate for money they don't need.
Well, like I had been a prior landscaper, so I definitely had that going for me. You know, I had landscaping type of equipment. We had dump trucks, we had trailers, you know, so I definitely had that leverage that not everybody else would have. But I would say just even getting in the standard landscape business and doing it different than the next guy, you know, offer organic services. I learned a lot from cutting grass and hustling and being out there and getting, you know, 40 yards done in a day. It taught me a lot about business. It taught me a lot about drive. It taught me a lot about being able to hold a pace. You know, learned how to work in the heat. You're seeing these plants every day. So there's a lot of benefits from that. But, you know, when we first started transitioning into the ecological edible direction, I mean, I was selling mulch, plants, compost, biochar, compost tea applications, you know, installation, consultation, like 10 different things, you know. So there's all the different little niches in this market that you could get into, whether it be, I think compost tea applications is huge.
Yeah, it's a big markup too. It's mainly just time and brewing some good quality tea that gets results and then charging people a good amount of money for it and driving around with your vehicle and it's a big tank.
I think if I wanted to do the thing that was the most profitable, that would be it. I'm not in it for just the money, you know.
Yeah, of course.
I'm in it to transition yards and
make a difference too, besides just spraying compost tea.
As my buddy Mike would say here, you know, a lot less grass holes, you know. Don't be a grass hole, you know. I mean, stop watering your grass, stop chemicalizing your grass. It's doing nothing, you know. I mean, us on our pretty grass, you know. And it's so funny because I come from that background originally. So I would say you could get into the standard landscape business and you know, that's A, it's going to put you into a truck. It's going to give you the equipment and it's very easy to transition once you're on that kind of path of working for yourself. You know, and start learning about plants. Take a PDC. I look at that as a kindergarten level of education, but a great starter to start learning, you know. Meet these local guys doing weed walks. Like, I'm really lucky. Yeah, we got Green Deans and Andy Firks and all these epic plant people here in Florida. Like, find the epic plant people by you. They're not just by me, you know, they're everywhere. You know, there's, find the John Kohlers, you know, find these epic YouTube channels, you know. I mean, you don't need to learn it all overnight. You just need to do something and get started.
Wow, amazing and inspirational at the same time. So Pete, if somebody wants to learn more, hear your inspirational talks, see your videos, how can they get a hold of you? What kind of social media do you have? Share that right now. Also put links down below in the description for you guys.
Yeah, so I'm on, obviously, YouTube, Pete Canaris, Green Dreams FL. We're on Instagram. If you wanted to see more of my day-to-day life, I post a lot on Instagram. I'm on there probably more than any other platform. I post on the stories. So if you want to keep up with my daily routine, you know, you can see me on there. I just recently joined TikTok. Like, you guys are going to laugh at
that. I don't
know
what that is, man.
So my son's on TikTok, and I see all that Gary Vee is on TikTok. And
what is TikTok?
TikTok is, like, kind of a new up-and-coming platform that's, like, shorter videos. I believe it was a music kind of platform originally, something along those lines, but it's where all the kids are. All
right.
And to be honest with you, like,
that are important to reach, like, well, seriously.
That's why I'm on totally there. Serious. Like, you know, kids put me on this very path. Important. You know, when I first started doing edible landscaping, you know, we look at the kids at the roots, you know, we don't fix a tree from its leaves. We start at the bottom, you know, so I'm going where the kids are. So I'm on TikTok, man. Obviously on Facebook. Yeah. We're all over the social media platforms a couple times a week and, having a lot of fun, man. It's just, it's an amazing path to be on. I'll never learn all the plants. I mean, you know, for those of y'all out there, there's 40,000 species of plants, you know, inside of that we have varieties.
Yeah.
You know, so it's 20,000 varieties of apples. Like, the sky's the limit. I'm never going to learn them all. John's never going to learn them all. Like, that's what makes this so exciting. There is no bottom, you know, there's just keep going.
Yeah, we need more of us doing all this work, making videos and educating, especially the kids, like you said, super important. My props go out to all the teachers out there that have gardening, you know, programs in the schools and actually keep your raised bed garden in the school actually active. It's too many schools I go to that have, they have a raised bed, but then it's just growing weeds or non-edible plants. So then all the curriculum is lost. It's quite unfortunate in my opinion. So, wow, great for that, Pete. Anything else you'd like to add before we start?
I mean, just what he was talking about with the gardens at the schools, that's like one of my biggest pet peeves is driving by these schools with these overgrown gardens and, you know, these grow towers and these gimmicks. You know, I think if more schools did like food forests and ecological type gardens, that would be more successful. Like, I've seen like this one at Learning Gate here in Lutz. You know, they have a permaculture garden like that. Wow. That garden's been there for 10 years. It's not like these other schools. And I think you're so right. You know, it's about teaching the kids and getting into these schools. You know, I mean, they are the future. You know, those are the ones we want to inspire and give this knowledge to.
And hopefully my videos go out to lots of kids and I try to make it kid friendly in my language in most cases. But I'm just unfiltered as it is. And I think I did make a video, actually a cool video with this guy Morio in like Miami. Actually, he has like a high school where he put in this whole permaculture food forest the kids take care of. And I mean, it'd be hard to destroy that because it's not annuals. You just grow, and the problem is they got to keep trimming it, trimming it down. But yeah, in proper climates, that can be definitely the way to go, in my opinion, and create a whole curriculum around that. I mean, and that's the other thing that needs education. People need to be educated about perennial plants versus annual plants and the benefits of perennials, and to grow more perennials in your area. Even if you snow during the winter, you could grow perennials that will stay alive underneath the ground, or ones that will easily reseed and literally grow as weeds that are more nutritious and even better for you. I tried to share with you guys some of those in this episode today. Anyways, my time is coming to the end here at Pete's, but if you want another episode of Pete's Hate Belief, make sure you click the subscribe button right down below, click the little bell, because the next episode coming up is actually at Pete's Amazing Nursery that you'll be seeing up next. Also, if you like this video, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. Also, be sure to share this with all your permaculture buddies, all your people that are not into permaculture, that they could learn more about permaculture and these amazing perennial crops that you can eat, especially those vegetables that I'm so passionate about. And also be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,400 or 1,500 episodes now at this time on YouTube 24/7, so you guys could get an education and learn all about the different kinds of edible plants and also the many different kinds of ways to grow them, whether it's perennial, annual style. I don't really care. You guys need to get growing today. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.